Memorial Day weekend 1993 will be remembered as the Woodstock of the fantasy film world. For those three incredible days, thousands of fans from 13 countries and dozens of fantasy film celebrities gathered in Crystal City, Virginia, to celebrate the man in the magazine that bonded them together under a common banner. The man is Forrest J. Ackerman, known to his fans all over as Uncle Forry. The Acker Monster, or Mr. Science Fiction, or Dr. Acula. The magazine, of course, is Famous Monsters of Filmland. Now, Forry had been a perennial figure in the science fiction community ever since the 1930s. He's known just about everybody in the field, from Bela Lugosi to Boris Karloff, from director Fritz Lang to Hugo Gernsback, the father of science fiction. Forry started the trend of wearing costumes to conventions when he showed up at the first World Science Fiction Convention in New York in 1939. He introduced the term sci-fi to the world in 1954, and as a literary agent, he's represented hundreds of authors from Isaac Asimov to A.E. Van Vogt to Kurt Siodmak. But in the dead of winter of 1958, he put together a little magazine which he wanted to call Wonderama. But the publisher didn't think Wonderama would cause readers to wonder what it was all about, and the name was changed to Famous Monsters of Filmland. It was supposed to be a one-shot, a celebration of classic horror and fantasy films, loaded with history and photos from his vast collection. And since it was aimed at 11-and-a-half-year-olds, it was loaded with Forry's trademarks, puns and jokes. Well, Forry's Folly, as it was called by some, was the one-shot heard around the world, and it stayed in continuous publication for 25 years. Famous Monsters had a profound influence on a whole generation, and many of its readers went on to careers in the movies. There was Steven Spielberg and John Landis and Joe Dante. There was also Stephen King, George Lucas, Jim Danforth, and hundreds of others. They all acknowledged Famous Monsters of Filmland and Forry Ackerman as their inspirators. In fact, I owe my own foray into horror to Forry. It was he who prodded me to audition for the lead in Mausoleum. Now, even though FM had ceased publication in 1982, Forry continued his activities in science fiction, running his agency, authoring several books, attending conventions all over the world, and appearing in 44 cameo film roles, and generally just being Forry. Then in 1990, he teamed with Charter FM reader Ray Ferry, and together they released a line of videos and trading cards based on the magazine. It was aimed at both the older readers as well as the new generation who had missed the fun in the early days. The line proved to be highly successful, and slowly but surely, fans were crying more and more, just as they had done 35 years before. With 1993 being the 35th anniversary of Famous Monsters, Ray and his partner Gene Reynolds decided the time was right to throw a party for everyone who loved FM and Uncle Forry. Well, the 35th anniversary Famous Monsters convention turned out to be as unique and unparalleled as the magazine had celebrated. During the next hour, we're going to take you back to relive that magic weekend. And if you're like most fans who attended, you didn't have the time to see it all. So here's your chance to make up what you've missed. And if you couldn't attend, we think you'll enjoy this bat's eye view of the festivities. Well, the sun's gone down, so why don't we get Uncle Forry out here to get things going?
Disturb. Who dares disturb the sleep of...
Goodbye, Forry.
Of the...
Goodbye, Forry.
Thank you. vampire.
So, how did all this get started?
Well, last night I was strolling along down by the boulevard.
No. The convention.
Oh, that fabulous convention.
Yeah.
Well, in the beginning, Ray Bradbury was over in Paris. I faxed him, and when I got a wee-wee, monsieur, that he would attend, I thought, well, we're on our way. Now, if we can just get the great animator, Ray Harryhausen, over in London. And when Harryhausen said yes, I thought, well, we have the unholy three here, so we're on our way. Well, I contacted Robert Bloch and John Agar and John Landis, Joe Dante, just everybody was saying, yes, count me in, Gloria Stewart. Mm-hmm. So before long, the sponsor got kind of concerned. He said, well, good grief, you know, so many stellar personalities. Are we going to have any room for the fans?
Well, the fans were there in force. Over 1,800 people had come in on Thursday to attend the entire 3 days. The Hyatt was sold out along with two additional neighboring hotels. Ray and company worked feverishly through the night to get everything ready for the Friday opening. A large draped stage was set up in the main ballroom with additional rooms set up for autographs, smaller seminars, and film screenings. Over 150 artifacts from the Acker Museum were brought out and put on display, including several Ray Harryhausen stop motion models, posters, and original art. Bela Lugosi's Dracula cape, one of Lon Chaney's makeup kits, Marcel Delgado's dinosaurs from King Kong, the Ultima Futura Automaton Robotrics recreation, and even the original Robbie the Robot. There was a 27,000 square foot dealers expo with over 100 dealers selling just about everything you could think of. Model kits, photos, posters, original art, films, videos, and of course vintage issues of famous monsters of Filmland for fans who were eager to complete their collections. Festivities officially got underway.
I'm really going to enjoy this because about all I saw all weekend was my hand signing my name about 10,000 times.
Will you sign this before you leave?
There comes a time when everybody in this world should grow up. But the people here who come to this convention are never going to grow up.
Happy 35th anniversary, Forry, everybody!
I'm reminded, turning back the clock to about 1975, when Peter Cushing got such a rousing ovation. And the end of it, he said, "Have you ever felt unwanted?" 35 years ago, I created what they call Forry's Folly. And they, back in New York, they were laughing at this mixed-up monster magazine with all kind of crazy pictures in it, and I was in a swimming pool with a number of people who didn't know me from the proverbial Adam, and one mother said to another, said, "You wouldn't believe the magazine, that crazy thing that my kid brought home," said there was a picture of a mummy fell into a swimming pool, and they wrote, "Became an instant mud pie," and everybody in the pool was breaking up over that. Well, frankly, I didn't think 35 years ago there would be 190 issues of the magazine before it came to a temporary end. I say temporary because after 10 years on the shelf, I'm coming back this evening at 6 o'clock. You'll see unveiling of issue number 200. Those of you who followed it from the beginning may recall it stopped at 191. You wonder what became of 192 and so on. Well, we're going to do something unique, I think, in magazine publishing. Eventually, we're going to do 199, then bring out 198, and 197, 196. And speaking of bringing out, about 15, 17 years ago, I got an invitation to come out to MGM Studios and see the preview of a picture called Schlock, the Banana Monster. Well, I was leaving for Europe the next day at about 5:30 in the morning, and I realized I wouldn't get home till about 12:30, so I thought, I don't know, do I really need to see something called Schlock? Nobody had ever heard of John Landis at the time. A favorite uncle had given him $60,000 and said, "Okay, kid, go make a movie." But ever since I was 5 and a half, I had this reputation that I've tried to see every fantastic movie ever made. And so I thought, well, I guess I've got to go. Well, after the preview, I was walking out in the parking lot, and a lone figure came loping along in the moonlight, tapped me on the shoulder, and said, "Mr. Ackerman?" And I said, "Well, a little late to deny it now, yes." And he said, "Well, there are just three people whose opinion I would value about my movie: Orson Welles, Alfred Hitchcock, and yourself." And I thought, well, even if I'm low man on the totem pole, you know, that's pretty impressive billing. So I looked at the young John Landis very severely. I said, "Are you responsible for that movie I just saw?" And he kind of backed away, and he said, "Yes, sir." And I said, "Well, you'll hear from my lawyer on Monday." And he said, "Oh, my God, you know, what's the matter? Why would you want to sue me?" I said, "Well, isn't it evident? I mean, look at this suit down on the floor, rolling around laughing, ruined. I mean, who's going to pay for this?" So, by the way, I'm still waiting to pay that bill, so let's bring him out at this time, John Landis.
Anyway, do you ever see The Man Who Shot Liberty Valance? Remember Print the Legend? That's Forry. That's, I actually was not allowed to have Famous Monsters of Filmland in my house because I had a little brother and my mother thought it was too gruesome. There was a photo, I don't know what it was, from a William Castle movie probably. There was a photograph of a blonde lady with a hatchet in her head. And that was it. No, I never had the magazines, but my cousin Scott had the magazines. So I used to read them at his house. And what makes Famous Monsters special to me isn't Famous Monsters so much as Forry, who, as you know, lives in Horrorwood, California, in the Acker Mansion. I think he has some of the stuff here, right?
Yeah,
there's some stuff here, but Forry's house, I was at the original Acker Mansion over on Olympic near Ships, was amazing. I mean, he had extraordinary things in that house, and he opened it to anyone who came. He's probably been ripped off more than most humans, and he just has a tremendous generosity of spirit to which everyone has always responded to. And I think that's why you got such a stellar and bizarre assemblage here at this convention. FM for me was great because it had something a little different than most monster magazines and film magazines certainly, was it wasn't just about the actors. They had stuff on Karloff and Lugosi, et cetera, Christopher Lee. But more interesting to me, it had articles on people like Ray Harryhausen and Willis O'Brien and Jack Pierce and James Whale, people who made the movies. And with all the bad puns and the mediocre printing and all that stuff, it still gave you a lot of information. And some of it correct, too. You know. But it's true, I did meet Forry after a screening of Schlock, which is like an epiphany, it's so apropos. And when we added scenes, because the picture was only 76 minutes, and so they said it had to be 80 minutes. I thought, couldn't we have like long titles? No. So we added two scenes, and Forry was not only in the audience sitting behind the Schlockthropus, he also sat behind Michael Jackson in Thriller. He showed up as the President of the United States and Amazon Women of the Moon. What else? You were in Into the Night. You were in
Kentucky Fried Movie.
Kentucky Fried Movie, my second movie. Where, Innocent Blood. Yeah. What? Some Oscar.
Oscar.
Oscar. Yeah. He sat in that.
Dracula. Dracula versus Frankenstein.
Yeah, but that wasn't my fault. Come on. I'm just talking about my movies. Come on. Anyway, the toddlers who were influenced by Foy Ackerman, some of whom are out of prison now. No, dead. Are a pretty extraordinary group. I mean, Stephen King had his first story published in FM. I let Forry introduce the next guy, because Ray Harryhausen's waiting back there, and he has a terrible temper. No, I'm teasing. But I'll let him introduce the next guy who wrote a letter to Famous Monsters when he was 13 years old. And you'll see me later. I'm on this schedule. I'm going to the exhibitor's room now.
Thank you, John. Just one final little note about John. He never did pick up the tab for having the suit cleaned and repaired. But in his first film, very generously ate popcorn over and over and over. And then I graduated from popcorn from 8 in the evening till 4 in the morning. I was eating cheesecake. And so when he said to me, "Now, Forry, in my next film, I'm going to give you a really juicy part," I assumed I'd be eating watermelon. But instead of that, he was my campaign manager, made me President of the United States, and some producers recently saw it and liked my performance so well that I'm getting a second term as president in Turkey's in outer space.
Okay,
waiting in the wings, let's bring him on, Joe Dante.
Well, obviously, if it wasn't for Forry, none of us would be here in this room. And if it wasn't for Forry, maybe some of us might not be making movies. As John Landis said, one of the things about Famous Monsters was that it was sort of the first movie magazine that was ever interesting to kids. I mean, there was Photoplay and Screen Stories and stuff, the pictures of Sandra Dee on the cover, and they weren't very interesting to most kids. But I remember vividly the day that I found my first Famous Monsters. It was at the Safeway store in Parsippany, New Jersey, buried among the women's home companions and, you know, Time magazines and all that. And here was this magazine with a guy in a fairly crummy rubber mask standing next to this rather buxom lady. And it said Famous Monsters of Filmland, and it was printed on that sort of Sunday supplement paper, you know, that comes off in your hands, but just a little. And inside there were these pictures of all these movies that I'd seen at Saturday matinees when I was a kid, and I had some of them I hadn't even thought about until I saw them again in the magazine. And what really happened is that a lot of kids who had this common bond of liking this kind of stuff but never really knew each other existed suddenly felt sort of vindicated, because I mean, it must be important. Here was a magazine, you know, all devoted to it. Now, unfortunately, this was a magazine that, I guess one of the reasons that Forry was able to go on with the magazine was that they had to sell so many copies of the first issue because they kept getting ripped up by parents and teachers. One of the things you wanted to do in Famous Monsters was you wanted to get published. You wanted to get your name in. Because one of the things that Forry liked to do was to, you know, put the people's names in the magazine. And that was like a badge of honor to get your name in the magazine. And little Stevie Spielberg got his name in, and little Ricky Baker and little Dennis Muren and all those kids all got their names in. And I was sending letter after letter.
Little Billy Clinton.
Little Billy Clinton, really?
Wow.
Why? Why isn't he here? Geez, he's right here over there, too. The idea was basically to get your name in the magazine if you possibly could. And so I sent letters about every subject I could think of. I sent letters about monsters with the flattest heads. I sent monsters with the most eyes, you know, and anything. And all the best movies I'd ever seen. And then I sent the worst movies I'd ever seen. And I hadn't even seen most of them, but I wrote it anyway. And all of a sudden, in the mail, I get this package with all these stamps, because Farr is a big stamp collector, and there were these letters, stamps from, you know, Mars and stuff, places you don't ever get stamps from. And inside is a copy of the magazine with my article in it. And it's all annotated in Farry's handwriting, which I still have, you know, and there's a little check mark next to my article that says, "Go, Joe, go." And inside, I open up the magazine, and here's this article, and sure enough, it's all the same movies that I had written, but of course, I guess I probably wasn't a very good writer. Forry had rewritten the whole thing to make it sound better, and he used all these words like symbiotic that I had no idea what they even meant. And then later, he was complaining that AIP was going to not give him any more stills because I had so many AIP pictures on the list. But anyways, the first time I ever got published, and it was really a thrill, but I don't know, it's also really a thrill to be here, and the reason everybody's here for Forry is because we all love him.
The most animated man in the world, Ray Harryhausen.
That's wonderful. Thank you very much. I first met Forry through a big gorilla. I always called it the gorilla of my dreams. It was King Kong. And, great. And I went way out to Hawthorne. I don't know whether you know of Hawthorne in Los Angeles, on the red car that night to see a revival of King Kong. And out in the foyer were these wonderful big 11x14 stills. So I wanted to borrow them from the theater manager, and he said he didn't own them, that there was somebody named Forrest Ackerman. So he gave me his number, I called him up, and he kindly loaned me the stills so I could copy them. And that was my first introduction. That big gorilla introduced me to so many people, Ray Bradbury and various other people, that I owe a great debt to King Kong. And of course, we met in the little brown room, if you remember, at Clifton's cafeteria, a small group of us, and everybody sort of looked at us with raised eyebrows because we kept talking about space platforms and all that sort of thing, which I think we were way ahead of our time.
Yes.
But anyway, then Famous Monsters came into being, and it revived all these wonderful old pictures that people would tend to forget, and we're very grateful that Famous Monsters is going to be revived again.
Of course, the big news was the return of Famous Monsters of Filmland magazine. By 5:30, the main ballroom was standing room only as fans gathered to see the unveiling.
You've probably all heard rumors that Famous Monsters is coming back. Well, for most of us, I think we all feel that it never really left. I've been amazed in talking to people over the past 3 years since Forry and I began working on some of these projects relating to Famous Monsters, that it's a name that for almost anybody who grew up with it, you never lose it. It's like your first girlfriend, you know. You find Famous Monsters when you're 12 years old, and then around 16, most of us back in the 60s discovered girls. and dropped Famous Monsters. And then you find 40 years later you want to go back to Famous Monsters because they're a lot easier to work with. We've all been friends now for 35 years, and I think, although most of us have never met, we've all been friends under one common banner, and that banner has been Famous Monsters of Filmland / Forrest J. Ackerman, because you cannot and never will separate those names. We've been honored that so many of his celebrity friends have joined us here for this weekend. And for this, could we have them all kind of come up on stage here and join them as we do this? Ray, Harryhausen, everybody? All the convention celebrities, could we have you up here? Come on, let's hear it. They're here for us for the whole weekend. Bring Stevens. Joe Dante, Dwight Fry, Richard Matheson, Bill Malone, Ray Harryhausen, Ann Robinson, Ray Bradbury, who just got here, John Landis, Julius Schwartz, Sarah Koloff, Ron Cheney, Jim Danforth, and Charlie Stewart. Walt Doherty, Angus Smith, and your friend Angela Larry Hoffman. And finally, the actor boxer. And now to help us with a little magic to bring back, I bring you the amazing Count of Magic, Count Lincoln Bond.
Forry, I think to present this very special surprise, we need some ingredients, yes?
Yes.
Okay, let's show them this box. Going to open the front door. Nothing in the box yet. I shall fill the box. I think the first thing we need are some colors. And I'll open the top door. And this looks like a good color. A little green. And a little red. That's my favorite color. And a little bit of,
pink.
I'd call that pink. I don't mind pink either, in case that's the color you have. And a little bit of yellow. And I think we need some special letters. Let's see what I've got here, Forry. Ah, monsters. This goes in the box. I'll close the box. Now I need famous. Well, I've got famous standing next to me, and I've got famous standing behind me. And I think some of you out there might be famous. So I'll just grab a handful of famous, toss it into the box. Are we ready, Forry?
Ready.
I think something happened. I'm trembling. I'm so excited. Are you excited?
Yeah!
Are you having a good time?
Yeah!
Because if you're not, you're dead. And if you're dead, I've got at least 1,000 questions I'd like to ask you. Ladies and gentlemen, FM 200.
The Thing!
The entertainment for Friday evening was a kooky game show called Harwood Squares, sort of a cross between charades and tic-tac-toe.
The idea was for contestants to silently act out a scene from an imagined movie and see if their celebrity partners could guess the title. A giant screen hidden from the celebrity's view let the audience in on the name of the film.
Freaks.
Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Hunchback of Notre Dame. Tarantula. Spies.
Center, put it in the center. Put the O in the center, please.
Joe Dante just told John Agar backstage that the tarantula scared you to death.
Yeah.
And it was Clint Eastwood. And so I knew tarantula already.
But he hasn't seen it, really.
I did see it. Jack Arnold directed it in the desert.
Now, boys, don't fight. Okay? All right.
Where? He doesn't even know who Leo G. Carroll is.
Now they go on, same people go on. Okay. X-Team. X-Team, who's X-Team?
Those two.
Here's X-Team.
This is number two.
X-Team used to be married.
Wait. Oh, we'll give you my time. Okay, keep your back turned. We're now going to show you the title of the next one.
All right, show the title. Everybody turn around now, and you can hold this, and you can talk about it. Yes.
Okay.
Gone with the Wind. No. War of the Worlds. Freaks. Disco Fever. Saturday Night Live.
She's having my baby.
What?
30 seconds are up.
The 30 second is up.
All right.
The thing.
What was it?
Mad Love.
Mad Love?
Now, you had to shave your head for that.
Oh, well.
Okay. That was pretty good.
Okay, so they didn't get a little marker there. This is very exciting. Okay, next team back up. Title number 10, please. Okay. Very good. All right. Okay. Okay, folks, you can turn around now.
Go ahead.
The music, I guess.
Gremlin. Thank you. Richard Matheson.
Thank you.
Joe Dante, sort of.
Gremlins.
Really, Richard Matheson and me, but Joe Dante.
Thank you, Sir John. Very good. Number 11, title, please.
Nope.
All right, here we are. We're ready.
Where's
our mascot?
We're ready.
What happened to us? Okay. Well, I couldn't think of anything last time.
Okay, here we go.
Okay, go ahead. Invisible Invaders, Night of the Living Dead, Planet
Nine
from
Outer Space.
How do you get
that? Very good. Very good. Wow. Where do you want to put the mark?
Well, they were good.
They were good.
Number 16 or whatever it is.
Don't cheat.
Ah.
Well, this is a hard one.
Okay.
You'll never get this one.
Never get this.
You didn't even work it.
Here you go. Probably American Werewolf.
Okay, Richard, alert. I trust you now, Richard, to say the right thing here. Frankenstein. He's done something to his head.
Yeah,
he puts him a helmet. Uh-huh.
It makes him easy.
What is that?
Oh, a Rocketeer.
Rocketeer?
That was good. That was very good.
How did you guess that?
I knew he put the helmet on him.
That man is amazing.
He didn't even guess King of the Rocket Men.
All right, next team.
All right.
Okay. Title, please, of the next one.
Three of us against two of them.
Okay.
All right. Okay.
All right.
Let me ask a question. In case you guys do, and where do you want your ex? You have to say it now.
We want our ex.
We're screwed either way.
Wait, we don't care.
On the first line, we'll stop them.
On the first line.
to up or left?
Well, they're going to win the bottom line.
It's okay.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
All right.
We digress. Come on.
All right.
There's a lot of people on all fours tonight.
Oh!
Alien!
Oh! That's terrific! How are you doing this? That's really nice.
Are you all right?
Did he do this with the face?
Did he make it a good thing? The engagement is off.
Okay.
This happens to be the last title. Oh. Okay. All right. Okay. You ready?
Here you are, sir.
Yeah.
There you go.
Richard.
Yeah.
It's up to you.
Are you people always your exes?
Wheelchair. We cured him.
Oh, it's a guy.
Oh. It killed him. Or he fell. Something. He's got some power. He was riding in a wheelchair. Wheelchair killers.
Isn't that one where he became...
I like that. It's kind of like wheelchair killers. It's the killer from the orthopedic ward.
Sorry, what was it? Huh?
House of Wax.
House of Wax!
No, that's not over yet.
We have to declare an official tie because they have no more titles, and neither team has won. No, you didn't. Because that's where we decided we were going to put our O. We lost, and you got stuck with an X in the wrong place. That's too bad. No, we win, and that's the man from Planet X.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Yeah. He arranged
it. What difference does it make?
Face out. Okay. It'll be on the screen.
It will be in just a second. Oh, all right, now we're going to show it on the screen.
Okay. Hopefully. Anybody who's my friend who can do
there it
signaling.
Is. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Now we're gonna finish this very mixed up game. It's gone. Okay. I'm getting out of the way here.
Is it a horror film?
I have some rather.
Well, you know. Go.
No, he's standing there with his hands. He's a tall.
Lunchbag of Notre Dame.
It's the Cuban film. 2001.
Saturday morning, everyone had settled in, and the fans and the celebrities mingled together.
I think what was so incredible about the whole weekend was how the fans and guests mingled. Every minute you'd find the celebrities chatting with fans or signing autographs in the hallway or the elevator or in the dealer's room. It was much more intimate than the usual convention where the celebrities are somewhat aloof and appear on a schedule.
Greetings, sort of.
That's because at this convention, everyone was a fan. Now, let's take a look at some of the highlights of the Saturday seminars.
It is really interesting. When you're a fringe guy, when you're interested in weird stuff, and you meet other fringe guys, it's sort of like, gosh, we're fringe guys together, and we can be weird together. What is extraordinary when those guys go on and grow up to become so influential. You all know Forry's influence on everybody, and Ray's. These are amazingly accomplished and distinguished guys. And they're still friends, which if you know them is really amazing. But it's my great honor and privilege to introduce Ray Bradbury, Ray Harryhausen, and Forrest J. Ackerman.
Now, you met Forry because he owned these lobby cards from Kong.
That's right, yes. I called him up, and I wanted to copy them because Kong, I couldn't get Kong out of my mind, and reissues of these type of films were rather rare. And as you explained, I went out on the red car, and the manager gave me his address, and Forry told me about the little brown room. And like Ray, I peeked around the corner when I first entered there, and because at that age, you always feel you're the only one that's nuts. And then later on in life, you find out everybody is, at least a little. And so it was rather awkward to meet these people who talked about space platforms and going to the moon and all that sort of thing.
Being around these people was so important because, and it was by a fluke in a way, I went into a used magazine store in Hollywood in October 1957, my last year in high school, and there was a little notice there about the meetings in the little brown room down in Clifton's cafeteria, downtown L.A. And I left my name and address there, and Bruce Yerkes, the secretary, wrote me and invited me to come down to a meeting. So I went down to Clifton's cafeteria and looked into this room at all these strange people, just like you. And it scared me a little. I was afraid to go in, huh? Because we're all nuts together, aren't we? The history of science fiction is the history of us fabulous crazies that know more about the history of the world and the future than anybody else. But I went in and I was accepted, and within a few days, Forry put me to work, getting me to write articles, illustrate the front of his magazine, and help publish it. It gave me a reason for living at a time when no one else wanted me for anything, huh? And so he was my first editor, my first publisher. He paid out all the money to publish my first magazine, Futuria Fantasia. So I'm here for many great reasons to celebrate Forrest Ackerman.
So, what individual answers now? What's an event that you can recall in your youth that had tremendous influence on you? For instance, who's someone you met? I mean, you met Willis O'Brien, right?
Yeah.
You, I mean, someone you met, someone you encountered, who just, it was like, oh my God, I can't believe I'm meeting this guy.
You know? Well, Willis O'Brien was, of course, my mentor after Kong, and when I discovered that it wasn't just the director and the producer who made the pictures.
It is just the director. By the way, just so you out of due respect to these guys, it is.
No, I'm teasing. I discovered Willis O'Brien, and of course I tried to read up. There wasn't very much information about stop motion photography at that time. They kept it secret, and for very good reason. And there was an article in Popular Mechanics that showed a great big gorilla with wires coming out of its feet, and a little man in the corner with an organ playing it as though to make it move. And that was very deceiving, so I knew that couldn't possibly have happened. And then I met someone who worked at RKO, and they told me about the glories of stop motion animation, and that hooked me. So I got my own camera, and it developed from a hobby into a profession.
Well, how did
Willis
you meet,
O'Brien
how did
you meet was him? My... I called him up at MGM. He was making War Eagles at the time. I was still in high school. And he was preparing a film called War Eagles with Marion Cooper, who was going to produce it. And he invited me down to his office kindly. I told him of my intense interest. Mm-hmm. And he very kindly invited me to show me. Because there were not, at that time, many people interested in stop motion. So I guess I was rather unique in that respect. And so I brought some of my dinosaurs in a suitcase and to show him. And when I entered his office, he had three rooms with three or four artists making beautiful oil paintings of these war eagles flying around a dirigible and landing on the Statue of Liberty's spokes. And I almost passed out from awe, you know.
But then the other influence in my life was dinosaurs, of course. And when Kong came out, same thing happened to me as happened to Ray. When Kong fell off the Empire State Building, he landed on both of us, huh? And we crawled out from under that gigantic shape and started a love affair with a 50-foot ape, huh? Which, and the great thing about our lives, all of you and us here, is how things cycle around and fulfill a kind of prophecy of creativity. Ray and I, being so madly in love with Kong for so many years, I've only seen it 30 or 40 times, and he's seen it 100 odd times, huh? But we were invited to the 50th anniversary of the premiere of Kong at Grauman's Chinese 10 years ago. And they sent a big yellow Packard, 1928 Packard for us, with double windshields and everything. And we arrived at the re-premiere of Kong at Grauman's Chinese. Well, there was a huge mob there and floodlights and everything. And we,
even
they
Ray
had a,
Ray was there.
They had a huge Kong in the forecourt, you know, not quite 50 feet tall, but damn big anyway. And Ray and I climbed up into Kong's arms. Huh? And when we got there, Fay Wray came running out of the audience and climbed up in Kong's arms with us and kissed both of us. I mean, how perfect can you get?
A great god came down from Mount Olympus in 1938 and was amongst us mortals one evening, the man who gave us the time machine and War of the Worlds and the Invisible Man and the Island of Dr. Moreau, namely Herbert George Wells, and he gave a lecture. Now, when I was a little...
He gave a lecture at this, at your society?
No, at the Wilshire Ebell Club. But when I was a little kid, a man whose grandfather had heard Abraham Lincoln give the Gettysburg Address, as a little boy, he'd been so impressed, he'd stood in front of a mirror and tried to stand like Lincoln and speak like him, and this was passed on, father to son, and eventually we kids in the auditorium at third hand heard Abraham Lincoln give the Gettysburg Address. Well, I noticed that evening that it was the short-lived period of the wire recorder. We didn't have tape yet. But I didn't notice anybody taping H.G. Wells, and I thought, well, I better be kind of like the Lincoln boy and pay attention to what he sounds like. So across a gulf of years and 3,000 miles, I'll bring you H.G. Wells' voice now. He was a small, roly-poly, ruddy-complexioned gentleman with thin graying hair, but he was such a great inseminator of science fiction ideas that I guess I expected kind of an Orson Welles with a deep, impressive, booming voice. And H.G. Wells said, "I am going to talk to you for about an hour. Today, east is west, and west is east, and they are coming together with a bang." And then he was quite prophetic.
His company, when I went down to Houston and to Cape Canaveral 25, 30 years ago, it was full of all the science fiction readers and all the fans that I'd grown up with. They'd all become scientists. So, and all the astronauts that I met 70 of them in one day before the Apollo missions began. And out of those 70, 58 of them came up to me and said, thank you for my life, thank you for my career, huh? Because they were all science fiction readers. And so we are the lifters and the pushers and the creators of modern society. The group that's here today and what we're doing and what we represent is more important than all the intellectual nuts in New York City, okay?
John, one of the pictures that I know you're asked about the most often, it's not necessarily one of the best pictures you ever made, but the brain from Planet Arrows. In which you are very good. The brain is perhaps a little less good, but there's a really cool model of it for sale downstairs with a spinal cord and an axe in it and everything, and two big eyes. Can you tell us a little bit about that picture if you remember making it, because it was probably done pretty quick.
Well, yeah, I was first approached to make that film. They wanted me to take a percentage, and I said, no, just give me a salary, and all you guys that are taking a percentage, I hope you make $1 million each, you know. And then we did, we were doing this thing, and I walked on the set one day, and they had the brain out there, and the brain was nothing but a balloon. And I said, jeepers, I said, that didn't look, you know, that's going to look kind of weird, isn't it? And who Nathan Duran, who, that wasn't his real name either. That's he didn't want to put his real name, the director didn't want his real name on that show. So that'll give you a hint about something. lo and behold, I guess it was a year and a half or so ago, I'm looking at TV Guide, and they have a section in there, you know, where you can get these various pictures. The brain from Planet Eris was in there. I said, boy, they're really neat.
So, Richard, was the Shrinking Man was your first screenplay?
Mm-hmm.
And what was the atmosphere at Universal at the time, if somebody's sort of working on their first big screenplay?
Well, I worked for the man named Albert Zugsmith, and I think because I sold them the novel, I had the privilege of saying I must do the screenplay. Otherwise, I'm sure they wouldn't have hired me, because I had never did a screenplay before. And Al Zugsmith was fond of reminding me that I had never written screenplays before, and kept telling me, I'm going to give you a writing lesson, kiddie, every time I saw him, as he puffed on his 19-inch cigar. And I overdid it, of course. Since being my first screenplay, I had close shots, medium close shots, sort of medium close shots, long shots, partially long shots. It was just so overly described. There was an anecdote I remember about the filming of the Shrinking Man. I don't know, maybe it's overly done, but Jack Arnold used to tell it to great success at conventions, and that is, when Scott Carey is down under the water heater, and the drops, they couldn't get the drops of water to come down right until someone finally remembered that if you put water in a condom and dropped it out a hotel window, it made a nice splash when it hit. So they bought about 10 or 20 boxes of condoms and were just dropping them down, and it made the perfect water drop effect. And later on, the front office said, Jack, why 20 boxes of condoms? And he said, everybody worked so hard on the picture that we wanted to have a cast party, and it kind of got out of hand.
Oh, God.
You couldn't use balloons.
No. So, Anne, you must be exhausted about talking about this now, about this picture.
Never.
No?
No.
What was the atmosphere around War of the Worlds when you were doing it? It was a fairly big picture for Paramount, wasn't it?
It was an enormous picture. I know George Pell, his picture started, I just kept getting bigger and bigger after Destination Moon. And so they handled this one very carefully. Oddly enough, Paramount didn't want to do it at first. They threw it in the trash. And Cecil B. DeMille dragged it out of the trash and said, if you're going to be, you know, sorry if you don't make this. So it was because of Cecil B. DeMille it got made in the first place.
And DeMille had wanted to make When Worlds Collide in 1935.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, he had a whole plan to do that, and they said, no, too expensive.
Well, he originally, I think, was scheduled to do the narration, and they got Sir Cedric Hardwick. I was hoping they would get Orson Welles. I thought it had been a great romantic touch.
So add a duel in the sun quality to it. The late Mr. Shallard is here.
As the
man who
and where is it that I am? I know one thing for sure. I didn't get to be part of that party, Richard.
This accent is why his part in Gremlins is so small. I remember seeing you as a cowled mutant in Captive Women.
Yeah.
In the future. I don't know if were you one of the scarred people or one of the non-scarred
people? I was
people?
Not a mutant, though.
You were not.
I was a mutate.
Ah.
The illiterates who wrote that script felt that it would not be clear if people were called mutants, so they called us mutate. You won't find that in any dictionary.
In Tobar the Great, you're a reporter. And you're in Gog. You get strangled by a robot.
That's right.
I think one of the best pictures that Bill did at that time, A Man from Planet X, he's the villain. Why don't you tell us a little bit about that stage that picture was shot on?
Okay. Well, that was the first picture I did for the illiterates who wrote the other picture. There were two writers named Aubrey Wisberg and Jack Pollexfen. Jack Pollexfen was a very strange-looking man. We all called him the man from Planet X. But they had written the script, and they managed to make the picture for $35,000. They did it in 6 days, and it was shot entirely on one soundstage at the Hal Roach Studios by Edgar Ulmer, who was a rather well-known director of B-pictures. He had a big reputation as a B-picture director, which meant probably that he was able to get pictures done quickly and cheaply, but still give them some sense of atmosphere.
Bill told me that the stage was so small that if you happen to see the picture again, the car always drives into the shot and backs out.
Yeah.
because there was no wall on the other side of the stage, so yeah. they would have to drive in and then back away.
Yeah. They then went on, they sold that picture for $50,000 to the Corwin brothers, who had a chain of theaters, and with that as seed money, they managed to attract a man named Albert Zugsmith, who later produced the incredible Shrinking Man, and he did
Touch of Evil
with
he also
Orson
did
Welles.
Sex Kittens Go to College.
Yes.
It's a very eclectic career.
Oh, yeah. He also did a marvelous picture that I was in, a really thrilling one called Girl in the Kremlin, in which I played, I can't remember whether I played Joseph Stalin's brother or his oldest son, but one or the other. And I can remember that I managed at the end of the picture to drive him off the cliff. But he, in it, Zugsmith made clear that Joseph Stalin's real weakness was having girls who had their heads shaved while he watched. That was the depth of the depravity of the man who destroyed the kulaks in Russia. You know, 15 million people died as a result of Stalin, but this was his really evil side.
Well, Sarah, I imagine everybody is interested. How early in your life did you ever see one of your dad's pictures or begin to realize who he was?
Well past puberty. I was in my teens before I knew.
Mm-hmm. Do you recall what the first film was?
I think the first one I saw was Frankenstein.
Mm-hmm. And what did you think of your father in makeup?
It was interesting. I've always been grateful they made the son of Frankenstein and not the daughter of Frankenstein.
Bill, at what point did you begin to realize what a famous father you had?
Well, I didn't realize that he was famous so much, but when I was actually preschool, I remember being taken to his movies with friends of mine that were the same age, and I was wondering why they were cowering behind the movie seats while the movie was going on. Anyway, that gave me a clue. But really, it wasn't until later on when I was in junior high and high school that I tried to be more invisible and blend in with the lockers because I knew my dad then, his name was known.
Uh-huh. Have you seen the majority of his films?
Well, of the ones I've seen, I would say The Son of Frankenstein. I haven't seen many of the pre-Dracula movies where he had the opportunity to play more diverse roles, and it's that group of movies that I'm really interested in getting copies of and seeing now so I can see his work before the horror typecasting.
Well, Dwight, how about you? At what point did you understand who your dad was?
When he took me to the movies.
Mm-hmm.
I was about six, I think. And he took me off to a triple feature of Dracula, Frankenstein, and King Kong. And I understand from my mother, the next day, he was very upset that I wasn't terrified by them. He thought I should be scared. But I just saw my father up there. He wasn't in all that much, well, in Frankenstein he was, but in Dracula, he didn't have that much makeup on. And I just thought, he's up there acting or doing something. And, of course, he had been an actor on the stage in New York, in the mid and late 20s. And as a matter of fact, he was in a play. He'd always played in New York. He played juveniles and comedy roles, young character roles, and even musical comedy, unlike what he then played in Dracula and Frankenstein. And during the late 20s, he was in a play called The Devil and the Cheese. He played a comic fop dandy sort of character with a little wax mustache and slick down hair and so forth. And another role in the play was that of Father Petrus, a Balkan warlord from the mountains. And in those days, we had seven newspapers in New York that did reviews of all the plays. And six of them commented very kindly about Father Petrus and what a strong performance he gave. But unfortunately, the seventh critic, who was Alexander Wilcott, who was probably the most famous critic in the history of the theater in New York, got the characters and the actors' names mixed up and reported in talking about the leading lady that Miss Lugosi was very winsome and Father Petrus was played by Bela Lugosi. And that's the first time that they worked together. And but I've always cherished that review where he got the two characters mixed up, and I have it in my dad's scrapbook now.
Ron, we've heard every once in a while for some years now our appetite is whetted by a title, 100 Years of Chaney's. Can you tell us a bit about that project?
Well, Gramps was working on that book before he passed away, and as he passed away, Grandma just kind of held on to it and really never wanted to pursue it. And several years ago, my grandmother sold her house in San Diego and we were moving. So we're moving all the boxes and furniture and everything. So come across these cardboard boxes in the garage and look inside. My brother and I are moving it. We start opening it. What's in this one? I mean, because it was just like a treasure, you know, you're going through all these different things. Gary, it's the book. Do you remember Grant's working on it? You know, we go up there and visit with him, and we start taking all these pictures out, and a lot of old family photographs, I'm sure, after seeing what's here. We have a lot of them that no one has seen from the family side of it, real early years. And so I started talking with my grandmother. I said, Grandma, we ought to finish this book. I think it would be a, you know, a nice tribute to Gramps and Senior. She said, I don't think I want to really do that. And I kept pushing. I said, you know, I feel there's still an audience out there. Or if nothing else, just to finish it, to have it done and in his honor. So she kind of started changing her mind a little bit. And finally she started seeing, you know, the opportunity there. And unfortunately she passed away a couple years ago, and she left my brother and I the rights to you know, whatever residue arises out of the estate. So it's kind of been my goal to try to revive that thing and get it done so you can all enjoy it. The title is A Century of Chaney's. That's what Gramps, that's what it was called. I know it's been called 100 Years, but that, and basically what it was, my great-grandmother was also an actress and accumulated what Gramps was going after was his career, his father's career, and his mother's career, and it totaled up to like 100 years. Maybe a little bit short, but I think now we can kind of complete the last part of it.
I'd like to tell a story.
Please
on you.
Do. On me?
You asked me earlier about my sons. Well, 100 years ago you did an article on my sons and myself in Famous Monster. And in it you mentioned that one of them collected stamps and one of them collected coins, which was perhaps true at that time. But since that time, people from all over the world have sent stamps and coins. One young man sent his entire stamp collection that he'd been collecting for 22 years. So it speaks to the magazine and all you've given to this genre. And because of that article, and because of all you've done for the genre, that I think each one of us will attest to the fact that you've kept it alive and popular and available to fans, and certainly the letters that a lot of us have gotten from fans are in great measure due to you and to your work in this medium.
Yes, thank you.
I was editor of Superman for about 15 or 16 years. Prior to that, my lifelong friend Mort Weisinger was editor of Superman for 30 years. And I always was envious of Mort because he'd have every summer off. And Mort went out to the West Coast with my boss named Whit Ellsworth. And they would gather material to work out the stories for the Superman television shows. I didn't see the show too often, I must say, but I do remember one bit of business I like to talk about. There's always a standard routine where some nefarious thieves are pulling off a job of some kind, and who comes in to stop them but Superman? And when Superman makes his appearance, the crooks do the in thing, they whip out their guns, and they shoot those bullets at Superman, and we see them bouncing off his chest. Then finally, when there are no more bullets in the gun, the crooks in desperation throw their guns at Superman, and he ducks. That is mainly my contribution. Alan, what would you have
well,
to say?
Well, Julie, there's one thing that has almost never been discussed in connection with the Adventures of Superman TV series that I'd like to bring up. Noel Neal's portrayal of Lois Lane through the 78 episodes, that's three quarters of the series, created one of the most interesting roles where a woman was portrayed as a professional working alongside of men in a very dangerous situation. There were only a couple of situations that paralleled that. There was, of course, Annie Oakley, who was... That's a very strange show. I don't think anybody can begin to analyze that. And there was Decoy, otherwise known as Policewoman Decoy, with Beverly Garland as a policewoman.
Oh, right, sure.
And there were a couple of police shows and cowboy shows where there was a female aide, but I don't think anyone ever got as close to the gunfire as Noel did, as Lois Lane. Has anybody ever addressed any women's group? Has anybody addressed
Well, actually, that? Quite a few when I used to do the college shows, which were so much fun. A lot of the little gals were working at the television station or radio station at the college or in the small town, so that they were inspired by Lois Lane to go ahead and do it. In fact, one of the ladies today here, the little red t-shirts, Linda and Laura, and her daughter's going to Rutgers, and they very nicely said the same thing, that did inspire them, that a gal could join the guys.
You inspired me too, because one of my earliest recollections is watching you type in an episode. And I said to myself, wow, can anybody really type that quickly?
Actually, I can type, as a matter of fact.
Noel? Right. Let's get into the show itself.
Right.
What was your first reaction? How were you contacted to play the role of Lois Lane?
Well, actually, the first one, as you know, I did for Sam Katzman, the serials with K.A.
Well, how did that
Allen.
Happen? Let's go back to your first contact as...
Well,
had you ever heard of Lois Lane? Had you ever heard
no,
of Superman?
No.
You knew nothing about
no,
it?
I didn't do comic book. I wasn't into comic books. I think then it was mostly a man's world. I mean, young boys always loved the comic books.
Yeah.
And I I had worked, I was at Paramount, and my agent was hustling around town getting his people work, and he found that Sam Katzman needed a girl to play Lois Lane in the serial. And he said, well, yeah, Noel could look like so Lois Lane, whatever. I had long dark hair in those days, like the comic book Lois Lane. And so that was...
Well, what was your reaction when you were told that your leading man would put on a costume and fly through the air? What was your reaction?
Well, let's see. I felt, well, it looks kind of strange running around his underwear, but whatever turns them on.
Well, you were shooting two shows a week, weren't you?
Two a week, right.
That's
we
amazing.
Did... 26 episodes in 13 weeks.
Did you have any cue cards, or did you really have to memorize
no,
everything?
No, we had to learn.
No cue cards at all?
They were too busy moving things around the whole cue cards.
Well,
so we'd sneak off in the corner.
Any amusing things happen, say, in connection with Superman flying or the equivalent?
Or like getting stuck in a wall.
Or rescuing you from a terrible
you
tragedy.
You did get stuck in a wall once.
Let's hear about it.
Yeah, right.
What happened?
Oh, they were our dear special effects man. Simon would build the sets you know, like the big fake rocks and whatever or whatever that George would have to break through. So this one first morning, they said, well, we're going to do this in one take because it's a big set. And we were all tied up in a cave or something, and George was supposed to crash in and rescue us as usual. So all of a sudden, they said, okay, everybody ready? Mm-hmm, okay, okay. And say, roll them, George. And all of a sudden, we hear a lot of kind of whatever. And George got stuck on the wall. One hand, one foot. He couldn't come through. And, you know, we all just kind of stood there. And finally, old George Blair was directing. He said, oh, cut, cut. I'm sorry, George. I'm sorry. Well, the wall had not quite hardened enough. The only time that Simonson ever goofed. But, oh, George was so cute. He just pulled his foot out and his arm out, dusted himself off, and said, see you all tomorrow.
Moderating this stuff.
You are.
No, I'm not. I don't know the topic. What's the topic?
What are we supposed to be talking about?
Anything you want.
Rabbi, a priest, and a... No, no.
He's told that joke about 8 times already.
What does this thing say anyway?
And I'll tell it till he laughs.
They'll be telling it a long time.
I thought it was a little vague myself.
Oh, modern genre filmmaking.
Oh, that's an interesting topic.
Are we on now?
Yeah.
We're on.
Hello, and welcome to modern genre filmmaking. Our panelists today are Joe Dante, Jim Danforth, Bill Malone, and me, your host, Zachary.
Good talk.
And starting the discussion is Jim Danforth.
Well, you see what's in your coffee, John.
Oh, wait.
Well, I think we all agree there is modern genre filmmaking.
Yes.
Right. We can all agree about that. And I guess
and a lot of it.
And a lot of it, and some of it even done by us.
I actually had an interesting thing said
well,
to me.
Well, here you are. Now, something interesting already has popped up, and we've only been talking for, a couple of seconds?
That's right. One of the attendees at the convention last night said something to me that I thought was really interesting, and I'd never thought of it in this way, a fellow named Rod Bennett. And he said that, you know, being younger than I am, he grew up not realizing that going to the movies could be fun. Because when he grew up, the movies weren't fun. They were seeing Easy Rider and things like that. And until he saw Star Wars, his generation had no idea that you could have fun at the movies.
Oh,
and this
right.
was like a sledgehammer on the side of the head to me, you know. So it was quite a revelation.
But you have to understand, it's not up to us. People always come up to me and go, hey, why don't you make the... And it's like guys sit in offices and either give us the money to do it or not. And... it's a very strange and magical and bizarre process. And when you especially in the fantasy thing, but when you take risk, like in my career, I've taken real risk with certain subjects. When they pay off and they're huge hits, it's no longer a risk. I mean, I remember Gremlins. I remember the word in Hollywood on Gremlins because I know it from the people who made Gremlins. You know, the production company, very unhappy with it. And Warner Brothers was very unhappy with it. The picture came out, am I exaggerating?
No.
The picture came out, an enormous and correct success. I mean, a huge hit, and everyone's a genius, and it was all, you know, they knew it all the time.
Yeah, that's one of the great things about making movies is that while you're making them, you're sort of on your own, because nobody wants to really identify themselves too much with your movie in case it flops. So then they can't say, well, he gave the go-ahead to that movie. So they all sort of don't really want to take credit. But as soon as your movie is a hit or looks like it's going to be a hit, suddenly they're glad-handing and high-fiving, and people who, like, never came to the set, didn't read the script, don't like you, you know, they don't care. They just, oh, it's their geniuses for hiring you, for making the picture.
Well, you know, when Star Wars, before Star Wars came out in 1977, the common belief in Hollywood was science fiction pictures aren't worth making because they're too expensive and only a very small group of audience will go see it, you know, and that's the way they treated those kind of pictures. And I think horror films are kind of in that malaise, if you will, at the moment. And I think that somebody's going to come along and make a picture, a big horror picture, and they're going to...
Well, Dracula's. Fantasy's Dracula's.
Yeah, Dracula has sort of taken the curse off it. And that was a period picture. And it's, you know, a classy subject, treated classily. And now they want to do Frankenstein the same way.
The major difference in fantasy film is in the technical stuff. there are all these pictures, these low-budget pictures made in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, where they're pretty good. The scripts are good, the acting's good, the direction's good, but once the monster comes on, they're completely stupid. They got ping pong, you know, they're ridiculous. Or when you cut to the spaceship, you know, it's really bad. And starting in the 70s, and it's literally our generation, but starting in the 70s, where you had those weirdo Rick Bakers and, you know, all those guys starting to get into it, what the big change now is there are terrible movies with great monsters and great special effects. And that's the biggest change for me.
Frank, I don't know, I've always been fascinated. So we've known each other since about the 70s, and I didn't realize until a few years ago you are actually, I believe, a marine biologist.
This is my standard story. I never intended to be an actress. I had no desire to be one ever, and I walked into the wrong room one day by mistake, and they put me in a movie. This is a true story. But I was a scientist. I studied marine biology, and I was working on dolphin communication, which got me kicked out of graduate school. And because in San Diego, where I was studying, it was the center for the Navy, who was strapping bombs on dolphin backs, and it was also a center for the tuna fishing industry, which was slaughtering 1,000 dolphins a day at that time. So nobody really wanted to talk to them. You know, no one particularly cared whether they were intelligent or not, because then you'd have to feel really guilty about killing them. Movies was just a complete accident. I was literally in the wrong room. It was the right place at the right time. And I didn't intend to be in horror films. I didn't intend to do cult movies. It was just what was available at the time. And this was like the early to mid 80s. There were a lot of slasher films being made, and they need not one, not two, but 12 pretty girls, all to take showers and die horribly. So it was very, very easy to get a job. And, you know, that's just how it happened. The first movie I did was a Roger Corman film. And it was called Slumber Party Massacre, and I took a shower and I died horribly. And it started a trend. And that's just how it happened. And then I liked it eventually, because I always liked science fiction and horror as a kid. And I didn't mind doing this at all. So it just, one thing led to another, and here I am talking to you guys. Thank you.
Tall man from Phantasm, and also another, yeah, there he goes. But I don't think many of them realize that you are also the recipient of a Grammy.
Yes, well, I found in the early years making a living at acting was at best problematical. So I worked for a while at TV Guide magazine, and also for a magazine called Cinema, which came out of Hollywood in the 1960s,
right,
as an associate editor. And for years I have written album notes, starting about 1958, when Capitol Records, the big round tower building near Hollywood and Vine, ran a blind ad in the Times, and I answered it. And I always loved music. So I wrote a note for a Peggy Lee album, which they printed, and then did some more, and got on their staff, and did notes for Sinatra, and Nat Cole, and Ella Fitzgerald, Judy Garland, Liza's first album, I think. Many good old jazz stars like Cannonball Adderley and George Shearing. They had a vast country and western lineup, Two Buck Owens and Merle Haggard and Rose Mafus and Rose Maddox. It was a great place to work, just all these brilliant musical talents coming in and out all the time. Then I go, oh, here's Bobby.
Bobby, proceed, ladies and gentlemen.
So to finish that up very quickly, I got, what, 5 or 6 Grammy nominations and finally won one for an It's a Perlman album.
Yeah. Anyway, do you have a few words to say to the audience?
Gee. You all said your few words already?
Yeah.
Oh, and all that said, hi, how are you?
Your turn.
We're here to talk about
cult movies.
Cult movies. I don't know about any of those. I haven't done them. Someone asked me in the elevator, what was that movie you did? It's
surf, and I went, I know. Surf Nazis must die.
Yeah. Mausoleum is, I think, a bit of a cult item, too, in its own way, correct,
Yeah, you know, when that came out, it was kind of a very, it wasn't a slash movie, really. There were some gory things in it, but it wasn't really a slash movie, which I am kind of glad now because I prefer it not to be. It will hold up longer than I think the slash movies. And I've done a couple of those, so I can't condemn those, can I? Mausoleum was a, in fact, I saw it in the video stores and it wasn't under horror movies, it was under Supernatural, which was kind of interesting.
Which is, isn't it?
Yeah, but I didn't know there's another category instead of horror or slash, it's Supernatural.
My sorority base gets filed under comedy a lot.
Oh, yeah.
This is, in many ways, a memorable event. And a celebration of Uncle Forry, and rightfully centered on him. But I wonder how many of you realize how unique this event is in connection with motion pictures in particular. Because you have here such a congregation, luminaries. You don't often see this many gathered at a world science fiction convention, or a world fantasy convention, or a world horror convention. You have here people who were the makers and shapers of the films that you saw as children and the films that you are still seeing today. I don't know what the art of animation would be if it hadn't been for the breakthrough work of Ray Harryhausen. He did so much to advance the field from the Willis O'Brien level, add innovation, do things that they hadn't dared do before. Then, of course, there's Frank Kelly Fries and what he's done for artwork, not in connection with film, but so many of the work of the foremost artists in the field have influenced the visual concepts of filmmakers. And he certainly is one of those forces. Then you have the particular and very special talents of the two masters of the genre, Richard Matheson and Ray Bradbury. I don't believe that fantasy today would have the place that it occupies in cinema if it hadn't been for the work of these gentlemen. Ray was the pioneer because he was the first one to break through the barrier in Hollywood and make people aware of the fact that it was possible to write science fiction and fantasy on a literate level. They'd done films, many films, but they had no respect for the writers as such. Ray was able to impress upon them the virtues of good writing and the fact that not everybody that went into that field was paid by the project or paid by the weak hack. And then Richard Matheson came along and did things in television and in film which set the standards for years to come. And here, for once, they're all gathered together under the big tent that Forry has erected for this weekend, this super circus, this three-ring, four-ring, where's the washroom kind of a celebration. I some years ago, wrote a novel which was adapted by someone else into a film which was directed by somebody whose name escapes me, but it'll come to me. And I remember in the novel, Alfred Hitchcock, that's the name, yeah. What he wanted to do was exactly what I wanted to do. He wanted to shock an audience the way I wanted to shock readers, by doing the unthinkable. Killing off the heroine less than one-third of the way through the story. But he realized, as I had intended, that the shock was there because by that time the audience and the readers had been grabbed, they'd been hooked by the character of the heroine, and therefore her death meant something. She wasn't the bimbo killed on page 5. She was a character. We knew what she thought. We knew her problem. We knew her changes in attitude, her last minute remorse over what she'd done. We knew what her intentions were. And she goes into the shower and something happens. It happens in the novel in one paragraph, and the actual gory part happened in one sentence. It happened in the film in a 45-second, truly memorable cinematic experience which Hitch devised. Now, if Hitch had used my technique and killed off the heroine quickly, shower stall like this, in comes, in my case, a hatchet, I believe, and off with a head, over and out, that sequence would be completely forgotten today. Who would care? They can watch any Z movie and see far more gore and dismemberment and disembowelment and anything else, whatever your own particular favorite is, and get the whole delicatessen, and it doesn't mean anything particularly. So he knew that it was necessary to do it the way he did it. But he did it with decorum. When I saw the preview, of the thing, not the preview, but the rough cut showing at the studio, I'd been invited. I'd just recently arrived on the coast, but he'd tracked me down. I sat there in the front row without any preparation or preliminary. Sitting behind me, directly behind me, was Mr. Hitchcock and Janet Leigh. And when I couldn't help but overhear, the lights came on at the end of this thing, and he turned to her and he said, "Well, my dear, what did you think?" And she said, "Hitch, when that knife went into me, I could feel it." And he said, "But my dear, the knife never went into you. Stop and think." I had to stop and think too, and I realized it didn't, and it doesn't. The wonderful part of it is that those 45 seconds are a series of quick cuts, if you pardon the expression, which do not have actual, and again, pardon the expression, impact. But you know exactly what's happened. And far more explicitly than had it been visually explicit.
Well, you know, I want to make a point about our lives, that we stayed in touch with our root systems, with our craziness, with our great loves. And as a result, it changed our lives forever, because I knew our Forry and Ray, and because I loved dinosaurs, because we went to see all these films together. And we were a clique we were very lonely in the midst of a world that didn't care. But as a result of loving dinosaurs, I began to write more about them. And when I was 29 years old, I wrote The Foghorn, The Beast from 20,000 Fathoms. And at the time, people said to me, "When are you going to write a screenplay?" And I said, "When John Huston asks me." I knew exactly who I wanted to work for. I'd seen The Maltese Falcon when I was 20, and I'd seen it 20 times. Treasure Sierra Madre many times. And I finally met Huston. I gave him all my books. And he wrote me from Africa and said, someday we'll work together, but I don't know on what. In the meantime, I sent him Golden Apples of the Sun, and the first story in that book is Harryhausen influenced the Foghorn, the Beast from 20,000 Fathoms. And in August of 1953, I got a phone call from John Huston inviting me up to his hotel, and I went to his room, and he put a drink in my hand, sat me down, and looked at me and said, well, Ray, what are you doing during the next year? And I said, not much, Mr. Huston, not much. He says, well, kid, I'll tell you what. How'd you like to come, live in Ireland, and write the screenplay of Moby Dick? And I said, gee, Mr. Huston, I've never been able to read the damn thing. there was a long pause, huh? And then Huston said, well, tell you what, Ray, why don't you go home tonight? Read as much as you can. And come back tomorrow and tell me if you'll help me kill the white whale. So I went home and I said to my wife, pray for me. And she said, why? I said, because I got to read a book tonight and do a book report tomorrow. So I read as much as I could and went back and took the job. And we went to live in Ireland. We'd never had any money. We'd never traveled, never lived in a hotel, never eaten in a restaurant. And all of a sudden, our life was turned upside down. In the middle of writing the screenplay, I turned to John one night. We were sitting around the fire and drinking late at night, and I said, John, how did I get this job? Out of all the writers in the world, for God's sake, you could have had James Agee and many Broadway writers, screenwriters. How come you gave me the job? He says, well, it was that short story of yours about the dinosaur falling in love with the lighthouse, the foghorn. I thought I smelled the ghost of Melville in that. I said, no, I was very honest with you when I first met you. I'd never read Melville. And but the point of the story is this, that by staying in love with a six-year-old who had seen The Lost World and the 12-year-old who had seen King Kong and with Ray Harryhausen and all of my friends in the Science Fiction Society, I wound up writing Moby Dick. Huh? That's the point of the story. Thank God I wrote that dinosaur story.
Yourself here at the conference?
Very much. I am so pleased at this particular birthday party and general celebration for Forry and being surrounded by all these neat people that I've admired for so many years.
You enjoying the conference?
Oh, yes. Having a wonderful time.
Great.
I was telling Robert Block yesterday that he completely warped my entire life. Thank you.
Excellent. I'm having a great time. Great time.
All right, are you having a good time?
I've attended 200 plus conventions. This is the best one yet. I've had a fantastic time.
Hello, Ford.
And what do you think of the convention?
Wonderful. The greatest. Hope there's a lot more to come in the future.
Hi. You having a good time?
Oh, I'm having a great time.
What do you think of the convention so far?
I'm 12 years old all over again. I just enjoy myself. I've come all the way from Chicago.
Are you having fun meeting all these fans?
Yes, but it's exhausting. It really is. But it's a lot of fun.
Hello again.
Going on among the judges here. Yes.
The Little Catwoman and Little Dracula get honorable mention. Third runner-up, Big Dracula. Second runner-up, The Hunchback. The winner.
A fella goes to his doctor, he says, Doc, says, he says, Doc, so I think my wife's going deaf. She doesn't answer my questions anymore. He says, well, how do you mean? He says, well, I don't know, like half the time. He says, well, that's too inexact. He says, we're going to do a scientific study. You go home and do the following. He says, you go in the front door and you ask her a question. If she doesn't answer, walk 10 feet, ask her a question. Keep doing that until she answers. Tell me how far away she is. When she answers, I'll tell you how deaf she is. Guy says, fine. He goes home, he opens the door, he says, honey, I'm home, what's for dinner? No answer. 10 feet. Honey, I'm home, what's for dinner? Another 10 feet. Honey, I'm home, what's for dinner? Jesus Christ. Walks another 10 feet, he's in the kitchen, he's about as far away as I am from Forry, and he says, honey, I'm home, what's for dinner? She says, for the fourth time, chicken.
I think that Forry is a frustrated actor, because when he read this scene to me this afternoon and said, would you like to do it, he was so perfect, I hesitate to work with him. However, you are going to get a lesson in not very good acting, but fun.
Flora, my darling, that funny little hat, I always liked it. You've been crying, Flora.
Oh, Jack, my father knows more about Monocaine than you do. It alters things. It changes things. It makes you feel differently.
Your father? Bah! He has the brain of a tapeworm, a maggot compared to mine. Baby face, you got the cutest little baby face. I know no other one could take your place. Baby face, my poor heart is jumping. Oh, you really started some baby face. I'm up in heaven when I'm in your fond embrace. I didn't need a shove, cause I just fell in love with your pretty baby face. Oh, sci-fi, how I love you, how I love you, my dear old sci-fi. I give the world a hobby among the folks in D-I-X. I even know my mammy's waiting for me, praying for me down by the Swanee. The folks up north will see me no more when I get to that sci-fi shore.
Way, 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 way down upon the dirty Danube, far, far away, there stands our noble alma mater, sinking in the swampy clay. Brain transplanting in the moonlight, making monsters too. Oh, how I wish that I were back.
Ladies and gentlemen, you know, I am so... I can't even tell you how overwhelmed I am by the way you've treated me here. And a couple of years ago, I was honored at the Golden Boot Award. I received a Golden Boot. And I thank them this way, and I'd like to thank all of you this way. And this is how I do it. In this world of ordinary people, extraordinary people, I'm glad there is you. In this world of overrated pleasures and underrated treasures, I'm glad there is you. I live to love, I love to live with friends around me. This road's not new, I've made it through. My friends abound me in this world where many play at love, and hardly any stay in love. I'm glad there is you. I'm glad there is you.
Do I hear 500? I'm afraid I don't hear a thing. I have 500. Where's that? Stand up, young man. Stand up. I want to show you a man that's got 500 over here.
35. 35. 50. 55. 75.
31 I have for a bid over here. 40. This is something you can really lose your head over.
105. 110. $30. What?
$35 once. $145. This can turn into a bloody mess. They're right next door to each other over here. $150.
$155.
What was your last bid, honey?
$165.
You have to remember, he's not going to be in it when it comes out.
How did you enjoy the convention?
It was fabulous. It was definitely an experience of a lifetime. Yeah.
Have you been to many conventions of this type?
This is our first Famous Monsters convention, and I found it supremely satisfying.
Yeah, I've been to some of the science fiction conventions, and this is just no comparison. This is the best.
So you had a good time.
That was great. Wonderful, fabulous. Wonderful. Absolutely incredible.
How would you compare this convention to others you've attended?
It really gave you a family atmosphere. I mean, I was sitting on a rug here, and Mr. Ackerman was standing on the stage, and I felt like I was sitting in his living room the way he was talking and stuff was going on.
And what do you think about the Famous Monsters magazine being published again?
It is something else, because it's like being reborn yourself, you know? I'm going to say, without Forry Ackerman's magazine, I would have gone insane a long time ago in a very bad way. But it was my island. It was my island Earth.
How would you compare the atmosphere at this convention to other conventions you've been to of this type?
Friendlier.
Friendlier. Lacking the snobism of science fiction conventions. Lacking perhaps the commercialism of the comic book conventions. People here tend, when they want to buy something, to want to buy it because they love it, as opposed to thinking it'll be worth more money in 5 or 10
put
years.
Put it in a bag and hide it.
You know what? I almost forgot. In all the excitement, there's one thing we never got to do. I mean, you can't have an anniversary party without a cake, can you? No. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary. Dear Forry, happy anniversary to you.
Thank you.
1928, how I could have used a magazine like mine. But it would be 30 years before Famous Monsters of Filmland was born. At that time, Bela Lugosi was dead. It had been 3 decades since Lon Chaney had been seen upon the screen. And I feared that that young generation of boys and girls would have forgotten them altogether. So I determined that Bela Lugosi should live eternal, that Lon Chaney should never die. And for 190 issues, I brought Halloween to the kids of the country every month for nearly 25 terror-filled years.
Think you'd like to meet the creature? He's in a feature like Christ, whose bulb is so fine. If the zombies say, we'll sing it night and day. Hooray for Halloween.
When primitive man made his first crude drawings on walls of caves many millennia ago, he was in awe of the world around him. Then when he began making impressions of things which existed only in his imagination, he took those first few faltering steps towards altering his prehistoric environment and becoming master of his own destiny. We've climbed a long way up evolution's ladder since those embryonic efforts eons ago. Yet as long as there are wonders to stimulate our senses, questions to pique our curiosity, they will first be contemplated and explored in that special universe that is unique to humankind. That locus where science merges with imagination. That infinity of ideas that Hugo Gernsback termed science fiction.
Cause I